Please pray with me. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Trust. It's one of those first questions in life that we have to grapple with, that we have to answer. Can we trust? Who can we trust? And our parents really are the first ones to teach us about trust. I'm in the midst of this with my kids. Many of you are with yours, and maybe we could say the journey never stops. But I mean, in these early stages of parenting, I mean, you're balancing like just trying to keep the kids alive and then also disciplining them along the way with kind of, reminding them of your undying love for them and how they can continue to trust you, okay? So no relationship can survive for very long without trust, right? And the challenge is we live in a world of mistrust, of stranger danger, right? Of suspicion, holding people at an arm's length, because there are people in our world who are manipulating others and who are trying to sell things almost constantly. And so it seems there's no escape. And in addition, we've got people in our own lives who've hurt us and who've broken our trust. And so it's tough, okay? So in this series, we'll travel along with those original disciples as they get to know Jesus and as they learn what it looks like to trust in him. And so we're going to learn the same for our lives today. And along the way, since it's election cycle, we're going to fold in some political stuff and some images and analogies that we hope are going to be helpful and bring clarity in the midst of all of this. But underneath it all, again, my prayer for you is that in the midst of, you know, this 15th anniversary of 9/11 and this election cycle, which seems to be kind of crazy, that you will hear the voice of Jesus calling to you saying, "Will you trust me? Will you trust me with it all?" Okay? So, 'tis a season, election cycle, it's like unavoidable. As much as we might want to escape it, who wants for this to be over right now and us to just settle this out and all the attack ads and all the other stuff just to be done, right? All the heated conversations, if we can call them conversations, on Facebook about politics and the like, right? In the midst of this, an important part of the election cycle is the endorsement factor. So different public figures weighing in and saying, "And that's my guy, that's my girl," right? And so you got people from a political perspective using their chips and throwing that in toward the candidate of their choice. And so you've got things like Ben Carson recently voicing his endorsement of Donald Trump when Ted Cruz dissed Trump at the convention and said, "I'm not endorsing him." And then on the opposite side of the aisle, you got Bernie endorsing Hillary and the like. And then, if that's not enough, you got this whole phenomena of celebrity endorsements. How about that, right? That's a special thing. So on the one hand, you got Hillary being backed by Kanye and Kim, right? And you got Leo DiCaprio throwing it in that direction. And you got on Trump's side, you got Willie Robertson, right? And Gary Busey and Dennis Rodman, okay? Yeah. I'm really not sure if this helps or hurts. I'll be honest. It's crazy. I mean, it really, really is. But the endorsements are an important part of this. People weighing in and using their celebrity, whatever that means, whatever their platform is, to give the necessary bump or in an effort to, right? And in the midst of all this, we might be wondering, like, from a Christian perspective, and some leaders are going to be real vocal from a Christian perspective, "Well, that's all well and good, but who's got God's endorsement, right? Who's God's candidate in the midst of all this?" See, that's not where we're going with this series. Sorry. We're not telling you how to vote. We're saying vote your conscience in the midst of this election, and a diversity of viewpoints are welcome, right? But that's an interesting, who does God endorse? Think about that. That'll play out in a different way in our message. In the midst of all this, though, we're praying for these candidates. We're praying for our nation. We're praying for for our world, recognizing what a crazy place this is right now, and praying for peace in the midst of it all, right? Okay, so enough of that, unless you want me to talk more politics, okay? We'll dive into the Gospels, okay? How about that? I'll tell you about Jesus. That sound good? Okay, good. So one way of looking at the baptism of Jesus is to see it as this really, really big, even huge endorsement, like the mother of all endorsements, or in this case, actually the Father, okay? So, yeah, a few like laughs and nods like, oh, that's good. I'm trying, people. It's the Father, right? The voice of the Father, okay? He's saying, I love you. He's glowing from heaven saying, this is my son whom I love. With him I'm well pleased, right? And so that's what's going on in this baptism experience. The Father's glowing endorsement. And this gets us to our big idea of the week. See, we trust Jesus because God literally says so. And that's even the correct usage of the word literally. So how about that? Okay? So it's a pretty strong endorsement. But backing up a little bit, there's some more layers to unpack with this baptism event, okay? Three in particular that I want to call out. Number one, this whole endorsement is staged at the Jordan River. The Jordan River. And if you know your Bible, you know that a lot of important things have taken place beside the Jordan River or through the Jordan River over time. It's a place where God has rescued his people in powerful ways. Moses, he was on his way out. And so Moses' farewell took place right alongside the Jordan. He raised up Joshua, though, and then Joshua proceeded to cross over with the Israelites through the Jordan River on dry ground, setting up memorial stones on the other side. Elijah, the great prophet of old, he split the waters of the Jordan and then was taken up into heaven. Okay? So bottom line, God does powerful stuff for his people in this very important place. And John is here baptizing. It's no accident that he chose here to baptize. And a crowd has gathered, and now enter Jesus. And it seems like as soon as Jesus shows up on the scene, Jesus and John argue. They're cousins, okay? Not quite brothers, but these two sort of Jewish leaders, right away, they take it upon themselves to argue. So get over the sort of reunion, whatever that may have been between these cousins, and they start talking about the nature of why they're there. And so Jesus is saying, John, you're going to baptize me now. And John, rightly, is confused. He's like, I mean, what gives? You know about why I'm baptizing here. This is an act of repentance, of life change, of turning around. This is a preparation for the coming one who's greater. Okay? This is for people who are sinful. And who are you, Jesus, to need this? And Jesus says, just go with me. Just go with me on this one, okay? This is the plan. You're going to baptize me, and it is going to be God's way of fulfilling all righteousness, he says, okay? Now, what does that all mean, right? To fulfill all righteousness. Well, remember the dove that descends? That dove, in Jewish oral tradition, that dove is a sign of a very specific figure who the Israelites were anticipating, the Messiah, and in particular, the Messiah, the anointed one, in the manner of, or the son of Joseph, is how it's sort of referred to in the Jewish oral tradition, right? Remember Joseph in the Old Testament? Again, Bible stories, okay? Joseph and the amazing Technicolor dream coat, and lots of good songs there, but more than just kind of a good musical, Joseph, right? Favored by his father, betrayed by his brothers, sold into slavery, spent a lot of his life. It was hard knocks. He was in prison a lot of his life. But then, through some miraculous breakthroughs, he got out of prison and ascended in power and influence in Egypt and became the right-hand man of Pharaoh at the time of a famine. Joseph, he went through extreme suffering in his life. But it ended up in a really wonderful spot. In Genesis 50, it talks about Joseph is actually talking to his brothers who've done horrific, unspeakable things to him. And he says, "You intended it for harm, but God intended it for good, for the saving of many lives." And so he reassured them that he wasn't going to retaliate or play all of that out on his brothers and their families. He was going to help them in the midst of the famine. So all this to say, this connection with the dove and this Joseph thing, it points to that Jesus is a suffering servant sent by God for the saving of many lives. In other words, Jesus' baptism of the Jordan, it isn't just about that, but it's pointing us forward into the future to when he dies on the cross. For the saving of many lives. Third detail, right? There are those signs that are mentioned in the reading, right? So the heavens ripped open, the dove descends, the voice, right? All of these things, they point, if you factor in that Jesus is there, they point to the Trinity is present, Father, Son, and Spirit. Now, remember in the scriptures, the last time the Spirit was hovering over the waters and the voice of the Father was speaking. Remember when that was? Way, way back in the very beginning, right? Creation. And so Matthew's trying to make this connection that here at Jesus' baptism, the fullness of God is breaking in, the kingdom of heaven breaking in, and God is doing a fundamentally new thing in our world through this Jesus person. Pretty amazing stuff. So, quick recap from where we've been so far, right? God literally says, "Trust my son." And so these details that I've walked you through, they all underscore sort of why do we trust Jesus? What's he going to do and what's significant about him? The Jordan River, that's where God rescues his people. Yeah? And then John arguing with Jesus to fulfill all righteousness. That's Jesus is a suffering servant. And then the three signs they point to, the Trinity's here and God is doing something new. The kingdom is breaking in. Okay? So that's Jesus' baptism at the Jordan. But Paul, the writer of some 13 New Testament books, many letters, and who looms large in the New Testament, he takes baptism as a concept and he bridges from Jesus then to us now in a very specific way. And he's sort of reprimanding those Christians in Rome for the way that they're living because it doesn't match up with who they really are. And he says, "Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. And if we were united with him in a death like his, we also can be assured that we'll be united with him in a resurrection like his." Cool, cool stuff. So that title, Christ or Messiah, we've already kind of danced around it a little bit, all right? So Christ is the Greek version, Messiah is the Hebrew version of the same term, anointed, chosen, sort of this kingly figure, this ruler, right? What does a king have to do with today? Well, it's hard for us to understand exactly what the significance of calling Jesus king today really means. We have presidents and other people, but this is actually where it gets cool. Because this title means a very specific thing, right? So what's true of the king is true for his people. If Jesus is our king, then what he's accomplished for us is true of all those who live in his kingdom, in his jurisdiction, right? And so if we live within the reign of God, under Jesus and what he's done, then what's true of him is true of us. This is where it gets cool, because his victory is our victory. His life is our life. And when we're baptized, you know what that means? We actually get the divine endorsement that he earned for us. We get the Father's delight. We get his adoration. and his commitment toward the future into eternity. And all of a sudden, the words of Isaiah from chapter 42 that were originally spoken of Israel and were fulfilled in Jesus are now merited and applied to us. This is my child. This is my servant. And with him or her, I am well pleased. This is hard to fathom, but just let it all sink in. Just let it all sink in. You can trust Jesus because God literally says so at Jesus' baptism. And when you're baptized, you get the divine endorsement that he earned for you. In other words, though you may not see it or hear it, the heavens are open, the Spirit descends, and the voice of the Father says, I love you. I claim you. I put my name on you. You're mine. And more than that, I believe in you. I believe in the person you are becoming in my grace and with my strength. I believe in what you can accomplish for the good of the kingdom. Regardless of your past and where you've been, regardless your screw-ups, regardless your view of yourself, however great or small, regardless the labels other people assign to you, however great or small, regardless your age or experience or lack thereof, you are being made new in Jesus. Gorgeous grace, divine embrace. Live in that love and seek those people who desperately need to experience the kind of peace that comes from knowing stuff like this. Seek to come alongside them and share that peace. What an amazing gift to experience through faith. So then if you're picking up what I'm throwing down, see, baptism isn't so much about us making a commitment to God, but it is really more so about God making his commitment and his promises to us. And this is why we in the Lutheran tradition baptize people of any age, right? Because of all that Jesus has done and who he is, baptism is about God giving us his divine endorsement, his heavenly approval and delight. Your baptism, it joins you to Jesus' death and resurrection. It joins you to Jesus' family and mission. And so, cherish your baptism. And if you haven't been baptized, I don't care how young or old you are, or if you don't know if you have, I invite you to come talk to me. And let's discover this more. And let's work toward a baptism for you, okay? So that you can know the Father's delight, so that you can have that divine endorsement as something to revisit when you just don't see things that way. Talk to me, email me, give me a call. Chase me down, right? Okay? And so we trust in Jesus because God literally says so, but not only that, recognizing who Jesus is and what he's done, we celebrate that God, he now endorses us. So you're invited to come along with those first followers and as the adventure continues. And all God's people said, Amen.